Hello, Shirley Adams with the Sewing Connection, Series 9, Program 13. Remember in Series 6 when I came up with a great new idea whereby I could cut and fold a fabric just a little bit and make a patternless coat that was so clever? It was so new. It really took an intelligent, modern mind to think of it. At the time, a little bell went off, which I ignored, and it finally hit me what I had actually done. I reinvented the wheel. There is almost nothing new that hasn't been done at some time in man's history. This was done 4,000 years ago in the Bronze Age. The remnants were found in a peat bog in Denmark and carbon dated to find their age. Still, it is a great idea, so let's look at some of the variations. Down on the table, I have a sheet of paper, and I'll tear it again just to refresh your memory to show you how this basically happens. You need to fold down the top. Now, you don't need a whole lot of fabric for this. Probably a yard and a half will be plenty to make a coat for you. So if I fold down the top, remember a couple of weeks ago I was doing a patternless t-shirt and I had folded it in half and then tore out the underarm places and threw them away. Well, on this one, we're not going to fold it in half. We're going to fold it just down far enough for the sleeves. I'm wearing such a bog coat and you can see the sleeves just stick out straight. So that's what I'm doing. However wide you decide your sleeves are going to be, then you fold it down that far. I need also to have a neckline and a center front, so I'll fold it again like that. And I'll cut out a neckline while it's folded here, a little hole for the center, and then I'll open the front of the coat. Now all we need, it's kind of short still in front, now all we need is to wrap the back around to the front. So I'll tear this about halfway, and as I bring this to the front, you can see a coat starting to take place. And as I bring this one over halfway, there we have a coat. All you need to do now is connect the top and bottom layers right along here. Stitch the underarms together, the sleeves together under there. Maybe use some sort of a binding all around the edges and you've got a bog coat that easily. This could also be used for a child. So down on the table I have some quilted fabric and there's just a little bit here that I have left over from some other project, but it could very nicely make a child's coat. So I'll fold this and do some cutting and show you how easy this is going to be and how you can do it a little bit more accurately. Okay, I've already made a couple of marks here which denote I want to fold it down this far. Now this isn't going to be a long coat, it's going to be a jacket. So it'll be a short jacket, somewhere in the hip area is where it'll end up. And then I want to not only cut this over, and I'm going to cut it over, probably about this far. Up to here. Now this is going to be a little past the center, and the reason for that is when I fold this over, I want to fold back a facing this time. So there are all sorts of variations that you can do. So I'm folding back the facing here, and I have enough left. These are really long sleeves because I have enough left here that I can fold up a hem. So plan all this in advance to get it exactly like you want it to be. And then the other side I'll also cut and get that over. Now this is a piece of quilted fabric. It isn't actually a finished side on the back side of it. It was commercially quilted. So you might want to line this. You might want to use some pre-quilted fabric that is finished on both sides, even make a reversible out of it if you'd like to. But anyway, we'll bring this over to the center and fold back a facing here. We're going to also then cut something here in the middle. A neckline is what we need. Now what I actually would use there is I would make a template. And here's a template I'm going to use on this. And since this is the center right here, and since this is the shoulder line right here, that little template will go in this position. Let me show you how I got that template. I took a couple of pattern pieces, a front and a back, and simply overlap them at the shoulders. Here's the front, here's the back. And if you just overlap them at the shoulders to that point where the stitching lines converge, the shoulder line and the neckline, it converges right there is where they come together. If I would overlap those dots, and at the same time I overlap them, if I would just make sure that the center back and the center front are on a straight line, because notice I don't have the shoulder closed up, it's open. I just want that a straight line. This little half oval that results, that's where this template came from, by tracing an actual child's pattern to get this little neckline. So, okay, I know the position in which I want it, right there at the center. And also, let me bring this back just a second to explain the shoulder thing. I have marked on this little template not only what the center is, but also where the shoulders are. There's a little mark here and here, and then there's an X where the center front, center back, and shoulders meet. Now, the reason for that is because your neckline's always lower in front and higher in back. So that's why the template is shaped a little differently. I'll just go ahead and put it here, and we'd cut it out. But because I don't want the back to come down as low as the front, I'll open it up to cut this out so you can see how I would place it here. I already have some lines down, and I'll take the pin out so I won't cut through that pin. And then we'll be ready to cut up the front of it. So here's the front. I'll just cut there, and then we'd cut around this template and know exactly how this is going to work. Okay. Once this little neck's cut out, there. This is the only waist on the whole coat, by the way. Just this little neckline. Every bit of the rest of that rectangle of fabric will be used, and there will be no more waist. So, okay, then it would just be folded over, and we'd have to stitch these two together here in some way. Let me show you a clever way that's back on the rack. And what this is, well, here's my old bog coat, so since it's in front, I'll show this to you first. But what this is, it was a really droopy, loosely woven, ravelly fabric. So what I did when I made these sleeves is I first of all folded it over extra long so that when I top-stitched the top and bottom together, I raveled out, I fringed what was extra there, and used this in this way. It was so droopy looking, though, because of that very soft fabric, that I decided after I had it all finished, I better pinch up a little flange here on the shoulder. And what that did is I stitched a little bit back in front, is it squared off the shoulders and made it look much more flattering. So this is one variation. Another one that I have here then was done by Barbara Gash in Detroit. And what she has done here, the same idea, but she's used upholstery fabric, some polished cotton, and she has a couple of them here, coordinates. So this one's all flowered and it's quilted everywhere to a backing. So very pretty, this other one that goes with it. She has brought her back flowered around up to this point and then added that coordinate for the front. On the sleeves, she did something similar, put that coordinate here. Also notice, because this is very heavy since it's a quilted fabric, notice how she shaped the sleeves up so that they aren't so big and they fit a little bit nicer. Now, because this is so heavy, she wouldn't even want that shoulder flange. This is better with just shoulder pads in it, which she stitched in later so that they can come out for cleaning, or this you probably wouldn't wash because it's too heavy. That fabric wouldn't lend itself to it. But let me show you what she has done here to get these two together. See how these two layers, both the top and the bottom, they've both been bound with some bias of the same fabric, and then they're bridge stitched together. So let's go to the machine and see how that is. Now, I've shown a couple of times on this series how easily you can bind an edge of fabric, so I'm not going to show that again. What it is basically, though, is just putting, this is commercial bias tape that I've used, and I've just put the raw edges, right sides together, and those edges are these. These are the same that were in Barb's coat. A top layer, whatever your fashion fabric is, a layer of cotton flannel that's in between to quilt to, and go ahead and quilt it before you do this, and then the lining layer is in back. And after these three layers are put together, they're just stay stitched in place, and then this binding has been added all around the raw edges. So it's stitching the right sides together, and after that stitch, then it's pressed back again, and you stitch in the ditch. This back layer just barely covers your stitching line. You stitch in the ditch here so that it all joins together and is in one piece. And then what she's done is the top piece and the bottom piece, and I'll just, since I only have one piece here, I'll just cut it in half to bridge the two together. I'll cut some off here. Okay, what she has done then is just put these two pieces together, these two finished edges together. And then what a bridge stitch is any kind of a connecting stitch. So look at the stitch possibilities on your machine and find one that'll do the job. It's just something that'll go between the two layers, zigzag, whatever it might be, something more decorative perhaps. And if you have for that an edge joining foot, this is really helpful instead of a standard presser foot. And what that edge joining foot does, under the platform it has this little rudder that sticks out. And as that goes just right down between the two layers of fabric, it does a nice job of holding them securely so that you can do a more exacting job as you do the stitching. So I'm going to push a button here. I already have, and I'm doing something that looks a little bit like chicken scratches or chicken footprints perhaps. But what this will do is hold the two layers together. So we'll see what happens with this as we stitch. And any decorative stitch that you have, just as long as it goes back and forth in order to join the two layers, will do the job just fine. It doesn't have to be a stitch that's exactly like this. Anything that holds them together. So you can see this is working really well. Okay, then after you have this all done and it's all bridged together, all you would have to do then is bind all the other edges around the neck and down the front and everywhere else, and you have a coat put together very, very quickly. Now, what I'm wearing is another variation of this same bog coat, and this one started out with just a couple of nice coordinate fabrics that I had. Anytime you have a print fabric, and this is silk, it's just a lightweight blouse silk, really. Anytime you have a print fabric, you go with the print if you're trying to straighten things or if you're cutting straight lines. Don't go with the grain of the fabric because they don't always coincide and it looks terrible. The print is going to be very noticeable. The grain line really is not. So here's to illustrate what I was saying. This is a torn edge here. That means it's absolutely the crosswise grain and it's very straight with the weave of the fabric. But look what it does to the print. Here you just see black, and by the time you get down here you're seeing this big brown square enter the picture. So you would definitely want to go with the print, not with the grain of the fabric in this case. So it's really thinking through using your fabric. I decided to use them in this way. I had about the same amount of these two fabrics. So I decided there's no way I can go with this as far as decorative edges. It didn't have as many possibilities as the stripe. Therefore, I used this one for the main part of the jacket, which was going to take the main amount of fabric every place. And then I just used all the borders in that striped one and the same stripe I used for the skirt. So, just kind of a fun combination of fabrics. Because it looked a little African, even though it is not, look, I sometimes start out thinking, okay, what kind of embellishments am I going to use for it? I didn't want to have this coat button at all, but I did find some beads that looked like they belonged on it. So these are wood beads. I would probably, when I wash this, untie the knot and take the beads off. They aren't going to go through the washer and dryer too well, but the coat will, since it doesn't have any layers that prevent it from doing that. Okay, so to cut the quilted coat that's on the rack, notice how straight it hangs, how flat. There is absolutely no shape in that at all. But because of the lines, the stripes that are in the fabric that I'm wearing, it seemed very wise to put some shape in because you could see where it droops. The bust shape, for instance, needs to be provided for if it's possible, which it is. And even though in the heavier fabrics, the padded ones, the quilted ones, you wouldn't necessarily need that, in the lighter weight ones, it really shows up. So what I've done, I'm going to take this jacket off. It's only partially finished. I'm going to take it off to show you. Besides, some pins are sticking me, so it'll be nice to get it off. But I want to show you what I've done on the inside. And before I take it off, maybe we can see a little on the outside. Can you see that one stripe doesn't completely go across here? That's because I wanted to put a little bust shaping in it. And so I did change that a little bit. So I'll get this off with all the pins intact, hopefully, and put it down on the table and show you what I've done instead of binding and bridge stitching those edges. What I have done here is, the thinking of this took a lot longer, I must admit, than the actual stitching. There was a lot of thought that goes into this. It looks like a terrifically simple coat, but it isn't necessarily by the time you think things through. Now, if you would do this simple quilted coat that I started, that is going to be just binding the edges to finish it off, and it will be a real quickie. It's when you have fabrics that you have to think how to combine them and how to cut them that takes some time. Okay, so you can see what I've done. Instead of that binding that goes around the edge that I just showed you with the bridge stitching on the machine, this time I decided I wanted a stripe that not only starts here at the center and connects the upper and lower parts together, but I also wanted that stripe to go all the way out to the edge of the sleeve. So this is what I mean. It was thinking it through, how to get the right stripes. And notice how there are different stripes in this fabric. Some of them are a completely different stripe than others. So it's, do I have enough fabric to get all the same stripes in the same places? So think before you cut. A lot of thinking. With this one, I then turned under the edges and top stitched it in place, just edge stitched right along the very edge. Use a lightweight thread here if you're working with silk, so it doesn't really show too terribly much. And what I knew from the way other things fit is that I need close to an extra inch here of fabric in order to make it hang straight down the front to provide the extra dimension of a bust. So instead of having this come straight across, I started down here and then I came up. So I did stitch across. Now this side is completely finished. What I did after I was through was just put another piece of fabric, whatever scraps I had, it didn't matter which of the two fabrics I used, I wanted to cover it up though. Because even though I probably will not take this coat off when I'm wearing it, I feel better when the inside is as pretty as the outside. So I like to finish it up nicely. What I have over on this side is the unfinished side, so I can show you a little bit more of what has transpired over here. Okay, you can see that this is still loose. I haven't stitched it down. I only started the stitching. And the only place, and you can see how when I put it together, originally those, the top and the bottom edges did touch, the ones with all the squares in, as I cut it and wrapped it around from the back, they did touch. But I needed to get some shape in. So as I wanted to shape this, instead of having them touch all the way along, you can see how, even though my stitching is here with the straight line, the lines of the fabric, the print, go way up here. So I was adding here in the bust area, right at the center front, I was adding that extra inch that I needed. So here's the transition line that just curves. So be prepared for something of this sort if you want to add shape. Now it doesn't necessarily need to add shape, but if you have a well-endowed figure, what's going to happen when you wear this is, of course, it'll pull up shorter in front and it'll kind of stick out at the hem in front, unless you do provide this extra length so that it hangs more gracefully. So think about that in advance, whether you need it or not. And so I did go ahead and make that change. Now notice also there is a little reinforcement place right here. And the reason for that, this is a fusible tricot that I have here. The reason for that is, I'll turn the sleeve inside out. As I was stitching this strip across the front and down into the sleeve, I had to change directions right here. This is a 90 degree angle. It was coming across the front and then it has to come out here for the sleeve. Now that inside outside corner, which I just demonstrated a couple of weeks ago, can be a little bit dangerous there because it's hanging by almost nothing. Rather than worry about the fabric raveling out and losing that corner, having it come apart and have a hole show, it's a good idea to reinforce it with a fusible tricot. That'll hold all the strain and you won't have anything raveling out then. So this is what that's there for. So outside of that little thing, which may be slightly unsightly, but it doesn't show too much, the inside does look pretty good. So that's just stitched then all the way out to the edge. And then to cover everything up, I put this whole thing over the ironing board so that I could have a surface to work on. And I took another scrap and just put it on top. I folded under the raw edges and put it on top so that then after I had it all pinned in place, I could turn it over to the right side and ditch stitch. I've stitched right next to this top strip so that everything is held together very well and nothing's going to fall apart. Something else that I have done on this is put shoulder pads in, one of them anyway. This one isn't in. Now most of these coats are going to need shoulder pads, and I'll just sit down here and show you what you can do. Now shoulder pads usually are attached to a seam on the shoulder, and we have a little problem here in that there isn't a shoulder seam. So what I have here is just an extra pad, and this one's not covered. I would definitely cover those pads because they look so much nicer if they blend in with the fabric. I didn't have a big enough scrap that I wanted to waste on the pad, so I just used dark brown fabric that blended with it. Well, the other shoulder already has a pad in. Even though there's no seam, this pad is sewn in here. If I choose to take that pad out to wash, I could, or I can leave it in either way. But anyway, you really can't see, hopefully, any stitches where that pad is attached. Now the reason is I stitched it in very carefully, and let me show you how that is. These are little back stitches. They're prick stitches is what they're called. And what we need for this is a lightweight thread, one that blends completely with your fabric, and get the knot started anywhere underneath. So I just have some pins here to hold the fabric on top, but this is simulating the same thing as I'm going to do on this shoulder where I have the pins. It'll just be a matter of getting it in place, putting it on in front of a mirror to make sure that pad's where you want it. And then after I bring the thread up here, it should be pink, of course, instead of white, but I want you to see it. Wherever you come up, you just take a little tiny back stitch so that it barely shows on the outside. And by the time you use thin thread and take a little tiny stitch, it really, and the same color thread, it really won't show. Don't pull it too tightly or it'll look like a dimple. It'll pull the pad down every place. So you just barely pull it until it's catching there. And I'll keep doing that thing all along then, what would be the shoulder. And I'll probably do another row on one side and another row on the other side so that it holds it in place nicely so that I can just throw that coat on and off easily and the pad won't shift around. I won't have to adjust that pad. It's going to hold. So even though I'm using a different color thread, this really, by just taking that small back stitch each time, that really isn't showing up very much. And I'm coming up, oh, about a half inch away. These don't have to be terribly small stitches. They just have to be in a great enough abundance that it will actually hold it. I've caught it on the pin, so I'll get rid of the pin. So, you seeing anything? Not very much. Anyway, just do a lot of stitches like that. It actually is only going to take you about 10 minutes per pad to put these pads in by hand like this, and it looks a whole lot nicer than having any big stitching showing. And since those pads are necessary in here, it's not a bad idea to do that. So that's how you put in a pad without having a seam. Then a couple of other techniques that I've used on this. For one thing, I have the edges bound with bias. And besides having those bindings there, I also have them just end all one piece of fabric. And then they end here in this tube down below. So the way to do this is, I already have this bias cut. And I have a wide bias cut. It's probably about 2.5 inches to begin with. And then I've pressed it in half, so now it's about 1.25 inches. I'm going to put the raw edges together, the bias with the neckline and anything else that I want to bind. And I'm going to do just a little 1/4 inch stitching. A straight stitch foot would do nicely for that, or any kind of a foot. Instead of a bridging stitch, I'll just put it back to straight stitch and go ahead and do this. And I still have that other foot on, but it doesn't matter for the little bit of sewing that I'm going to do here. Okay, after I have this attached to the edge where I want to then start the tube, what I would do is not put it around to the backside and ditch stitch, as is the usual procedure. What I do at this point is fold it in half. I want that already pressed folded edge to just be slightly below the stitching line. And then I would stitch this tube, is what it needs to be. I would stitch the tube. I'll put it down here and pin where I would be stitching. I'd stitch it, though, so that it just really starts right where my other stitching left off, and then go ahead and stitch the tube, and then use whatever kind of a tube turner you have that you can pull that tube right side out. After you have the tube pulled right side out, then you'd go ahead and flip this to the back side and enclose the raw edges and stitch it down. So you can see right where my tube stops, that's what I did here. That's where it's folded back and it's top stitched, or ditch stitched rather, so that it does work. And that's what I used for a fastening. Now these don't have to be fastened, of course, so it's okay if you don't. I did this same thing, binding the edge on just a larger scale, as I did the lower cuff, or the lower edge of the cuff, putting again a contrast in. So just a neat coat to make. But let's think of some of the other possibilities that you could do besides what we've seen so far, that heavy quilted fabric, this just ultra lightweight blouse silk, or here's something else. I have this fabric and I'm still giving this some thought because I think this is a perfect candidate for a bog coat. I don't really want to break it up much, and you break it almost none whatsoever when you cut it up this way. But this is a mallee construction, and what that means is it's going to fall apart very easily. I'm going to have to back this with some fusible tricot probably all over the whole thing before I start constructing it, just to hold it together. What I'm waiting for is, I have some other things that kind of go with it, but I haven't decided exactly on what trims, and this has to be thought through very carefully. I said this is a good coat to make maybe for children. You can make it so quickly. You could also do the same quilted idea on an adult level. And this is just pre-quilted fabric here. Both sides are finished. So with this, it's deciding again, I could make this coat in probably a little over an hour, not too much longer than that, if I would just decide on what quick bindings I can put. And the double fold bias tape might be quick bindings there to get it all finished in a hurry. What I made last week, I have down here in the table, and these were the scraps left over. That was using the blouse scraps and also using the outside, the coat scraps, and making this shawl. So the shawl, the coat, the blouse, the skirt, the whole thing just makes a nice outfit as it goes around and ties. And I like to use every one of those scraps in some way or other to really give a finished look. What you can do with your ideas and in your sewing room, it's just endless. Don't you just love to sew? When you can make something that remains fashionable then for 4,000 years, it's really withstanding the test of time, even though you won't be wearing it all that time. Time runs out, and that's what happened to Series 9. This was the last show. I'm already working on Series 10, however, so with your encouragement, your public television station will enable us to get together again real soon. Until then, this is Shirley Adams, The Sewing Connection, and happy sewing.